May 24th, 1941. Northeast of Iceland in the North Atlantic. A lookout from Britain's largest battlecruiser in the pride of the Royal Navy, the HMS Hood, spots two German warships in the eerie distance just 17 miles away. After that, shells begin raining down upon the Hood, and the Hood sinks quickly, and the Germans have won this battle. The ship that's responsible for the sinking is the Kriegsmarine's own super weapon of the seas, the Bismarck. And it's only her first voyage.
And every British seaman, he knew and understood, they had to sink the Bismarck, the terror of the sea. Stop those guns as big as steers, and those shells as big as trees. We find that German battleship that's making such a fuss. We gotta sink the Bismarck, cause the world depends on us.
Hit the decks a running, boys, and spin those guns around.
But when we find the Bismarck, we gotta cut her down.
The two Bismarck-class battleships, Bismarck and Tirpitz, were drawn out and planned in the mid-30s by the Kriegsmarine. The ships were created to counter the French naval expansion, specifically the Richelieu-class battleships Richelieu, Jean Bart, Clemenceau, and Gascony, which had started in 1935.
These two ships were incredibly huge, not just physically, but their presence alone to German culture was supreme. The two sisters were the largest battleships ever built by Germany, and one of the largest battleships ever built by any European power, with the Bismarck class being 823 feet long.
Bismarck, also known as 509, was laid out at Blommenvoss shipyard on July 1, 1936. The vessel was eventually launched on February 14, 1939, with the granddaughter of the ship's namesake, Otto von Bismarck, christening the ship, while her sister ship, Tirpitz, was laid down at the Kriegsmarine's Werft Wilhelmshaven. And 2.5 years later, on April 1st, 1939, she was launched. Right after the Bismarck joined the fleet as the largest battleship built by the German Navy of the time, a sortie in the North Atlantic was drawn up. A sortie meaning an attack made by troops coming out of a position of defense. The mission was codenamed Operation Rheinübung. Its purpose was to block Allied shipping to the United Kingdom. The force was composed of Bismarck, Tirpitz, and the two Scharnhorst-class battleships Scharnhorst and Gneisenau. Unfortunately, the Tirpitz was not ready for service by May 1941 when the operation would commence, and Scharnhorst was being overhauled. The force was then later reduced to Bismarck, Gneisenau, and the heavy cruiser Prinz Eugen. After the force was established, Gneisenau was badly damaged after a British air raid in Brest, France. So finally, only the Bismarck and the Prinz Eugen would continue the mission. The British intelligence had been building up a file on the Bismarck for quite some time, some actually attending her launch and then later on monitoring her sea trials via air and signal intercepts. Unfortunately, past that, they were blind. They didn't know her technology, her speed, or her crew count. Vice Admiral of the British Navy John Tovey and his fleet stand guard at Scapa Flow, the watery expanse between Greenland and Nazi-occupied Norway. Tovey's nightmare was only of the Bismarck, with the knowledge and unknown knowledge they have on her. An attack could strike the seas Tovey is protecting at any moment.
A new Polish report has been released that the Bismarck left port 3 days ago. As well, a Norwegian resistance cell spotted a group of German ships passing between Norway and Denmark. Royal Air Force reconnaissance planes are currently spouting out the fjords.
Tovey immediately issues an order to his fleet, refuel and stand by to sail. Across the way in Norway, an RAF pilot cruising the fjord spots and photographs a large vessel and a heavy cruiser that are slowly making its way through the fjord. The photos are sent to Scotland to be developed, where an analysis confirms that the silhouettes in the pictures are of the Bismarck and the Prinz Eugen. The photographs confirm as well Tovey's nightmare becoming a slow reality. With the weather slowly revealing itself to be a dense, dreading fog, the Bismarck makes its dash from a quick hibernation. Tovey summons his support Vice Admiral Lancelot Holland, and explains to him that Holland will take his squadron to southern Iceland and hold on there while Tovey will stay at Scapa Flow. On May 23rd in the Denmark Strait, two British cruisers have been searching in icy waters for 50 hours since the Bismarck was last spotted. Eventually, a lookout spots two ships from a distance throughout the snowy mist. At first, it is thought that they are British, but a second glance reveals them to be German. Action is quickly taken. The ship's 8-inch guns are useless to the steel behemoth. For 3 minutes, the crew of the ship sit and wait for the enemy shells to rain down upon them. Nothing comes of it. The British ship relays the message to her sister ship of what events have just occurred. The sister ship races on throughout the fog, eventually coming face to face with the Bismarck just 6 miles apart, but the Bismarck's fast speed of 30 knots is making her close in. The Bismarck opens fire, but the small cruiser manages to escape throughout the mist with no damage. The two cruisers stay behind the Bismarck in Prinz Eugen's trail 10 miles away, quietly broadcasting Bismarck's position to the fleet. Holland knows if contact is made with either ships, it would be a two-on-two capital ship battle, with the Germans having the Bismarck and the Prinz Eugen, and the British having Holland's ship, the Prince of Wales, and his flagship, the pride of the Royal Navy, the HMS Hood. The HMS Hood has cemented herself into being a very important vessel by circumnavigating the world as a symbol of British naval superiority. And now, she is steaming towards destruction. At dawn on May 24th, smoke is seen from the distance. Admiral Holland sends a message to the rest of the fleet.
From Hood, enemy in sight, M engaging.
The four ships are all running parallel to each other, so a plan is made to cut a path directly towards the Germans. Unfortunately, the Hood would be half firing power, for her stern guns are blocked by the superstructure, but that doesn't matter in Holland's mind, so he pushes to a full steam ahead. When they are caught up and close to the enemy, the Hood and the Prince of Wales begin firing on both German vessels. The Germans open fire. A few moments later, a shell from Prinz Eugen slams into Hood's deck, detonating stored ammunition. From the voice pipes, the crew on main deck can hear their fellow crewmates below being cooked alive. One shell is shot from the Bismarck, and the Prince of Wales' Captain Leach watches as that shell is shot from the Bismarck and lands onto Hood's deck. It disappears for 2 seconds, then a huge explosion happens midship and it tears the ship in two. The stern rises up out of the water as the bow sails forward like a chicken without a head. The bow begins to list to starboard. Admiral Holland is still being seated in his chair, just as every captain would, going down with his ship. The Hood begins to slowly sink in a V formation. Somehow one turret fires off one last shot, and then it drops into the water. The Prince of Wales slowly passes by the final plunge of the Royal Navy's finest battleship. She sank in only 3 minutes, and of the original 1,418 crew, only three survived. Right after that, Bismarck strikes a hit at the Prince of Wales' one compartment above her bridge. The navigation officer, who is one deck below, shouts at the voice pipes, asking if anybody is all right. Silence. A moment later, a stream of blood starts dripping out of the holes. Captain Leach knows he has been outfought and nothing is worth it now, so he orders his ship to turn, and in response to retreat, the Bismarck does not follow. The loss of Britain's pride of the Hood spurred the British Admiralty into action.
You are commanded to hunt the beast, that is all. I don't care how you do it, but you must sink the Bismarck.
Fifteen Swordfish bombers are all headed to the presumed Bismarck's location. Days before, messages were intercepted saying that Bismarck will meet up with Luftwaffe air bases on the French coast of Brest. Along the horizon, they spot the Bismarck, and they fly low, some 50 feet above the ocean. Bismarck opens fire. One Swordfish takes 175 hits, but they still glide. They drop their torpedoes, and one manages to strike its stern. The great ship sails on with a huge gash and smoke rising. The Bismarck begins to turn away from the French coast all of a sudden. They shot out her steering. Admiral Tovey finally has the upper hand against the Germans, and for the first time, on the morning of May 27, 1941, Tovey sees the Bismarck with his own eyes. Behind him is the HMS Rodney. Tovey's plan is to attack Bismarck from all sides, with the two battleships King George V and Rodney and the cruisers Dorsetshire and Norfolk. After some firing back and forth from Rodney, King George V, and Bismarck, Rodney scores a hit on Bismarck's firing control director, and all her guns fall quiet. Then another shot is fired and it knocks out B turret. The Dorsetshire and Norfolk begin to shoot upon the unarmed superstructure, and slowly it's falling apart. A burst of flame rises to the height of the mast. The bridge comes falling down. The Rodney becomes parallel with the Bismarck and begins to slam broadsides into the hull.
For 50 minutes, the four ships just hammer the Bismarck with everything they got. And at this point, it's just like riddling a dead body.
Fuel is running low, and Tovey issues all ships to return to Scapa Flow, all but for the Dorsetshire, who stay behind and finish her off. Dorsetshire moves to a point-blank range and fires two torpedoes into Bismarck's starboard side, and another into port side. Finally, the pride of Hitler's Kriegsmarine keels over and begins to sink by the stern. Within 15 seconds, one of the largest battleships of the world has slipped beneath the waves. 2,200 served on the Bismarck, and only 114 survived. Sink the Bismarck is a success. On June 28, 1989, the wreck of the Bismarck was found by Dr. Robert Ballard 48 years after its sinking. It was found to be resting on its keel at the depth of 15,719 feet. It was found out while sinking it flipped upside down underwater, causing all the turrets and improperly mounted objects to fall out onto the ocean floor. Then it did a 180 and landed on the underwater volcano, and it triggered a landslide. Bismarck slid down the mountain, slamming the objects and pushing them out of the way, then finally coming to a stop two-thirds down and resting now where it sits to this day. The Bismarck's lasting impact is still noted in pop culture, with songs and movies and books being written just made years after the sinking. Another example of a more modern day is Star Wars. In the show Star Wars: The Clone Wars, director Dave Filoni stated, "We wanted to have a Bismarck-styled battleship, so a battleship named the Malevolence came to be." Even in fact, the first historically based war video game was called Computer Bismarck, a turn-based game which focused on the last battle of the battleship Bismarck.
But regardless of how you look at the Bismarck today, the amount of lives that were lost from the Hood and the Bismarck will never be forgotten. And hey, maybe the Bismarck is remembered for being so much ahead of her time. Or the fact she sank in her maiden voyage. But at any rate, what do I know? I'm just a piece of toast on the internet.